Mr. President, distinguished senators, you just heard from my colleagues about the harrowing events that happened here at the Capitol on January 6th and saw that very disturbing video. I'd now like to turn your attention to what was happening on the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue at the White House. And the truth is, the facts are, that on January 6th, Donald Trump did not once condemn this attack. He did not once condemn the attackers. In fact, on January 6th, the only person he condemned was his own vice president, Mike Pence, who was hiding in this building with his family in fear for his life. In the first crucial hours of this violent attack, he did nothing to stop it, nothing to help us. By all accounts from the people that were around him, he was delighted. And here's the last thing Donald Trump said that day, and you might remember this from my motions presentation earlier in the week. At 6 p.m. on January 6th, after all the destruction that you just saw, the Capitol Police and the National Guard fighting to secure this building, here's what Donald Trump tweeted. "These are the things and events that happen when a sacred landslide election victory is so unceremoniously and viciously stripped away from great patriots who have been badly and unfairly treated for so long. Go home with love and in peace. Remember this day forever." He got what he incited, and according to Donald Trump, we got what we deserved. Donald Trump's incitement of this insurrection, including his dereliction of his duty as commander-in-chief to defend the Capitol and the people in it, his complete refusal to condemn the attack while it was going on, and his continued incitement of the violence during the attack require impeachment. Now let's turn to then-President Trump's conduct that day. I want to start at the beginning when he addressed his thousands of great patriots, as he called them that morning. Around noon, Donald Trump began speaking at his rally just down Pennsylvania Avenue. Even before Donald Trump finished speaking, his supporters began to walk down toward the Capitol, and they were already starting to chant, "Stop the steal, storm the Capitol, invade the Capitol, fight for Trump." And by 12:53 p.m., they had violently forced their way through the barricades here at the Capitol. Now, about 1 o'clock that day, with this chaos just starting, Speaker Pelosi, as the Constitution requires, formally commenced the process by which this chamber certifies the election results. Within 10 minutes, at 1:11 p.m., as if almost on cue, Donald Trump concluded his speech with his final reminder to the thousands gathered there that it was time to go to the Capitol. Let's watch.
"And we're going to the Capitol, and we're going to try and give, but we're going to try and give our Republicans, the weak ones, because the strong ones don't need any of our help. We're going to try and give them the kind of pride and boldness that they need to take back our country. So let's walk down Pennsylvania Avenue. I want to thank you all. God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you all for being here. This is incredible. Thank you very much."
Now, you've seen what happened when these supporters, following his orders, arrived here at the Capitol. But I want to look at what happened next. Now, you'll recall during the speech, President Trump said, "We're going to the Capitol," sort of suggesting that he was going to go with this crowd. Of course, that was not true. But let's hear what he said.
"Now it is up to Congress to confront this egregious assault on our democracy. And after this, we're going to walk down, and I'll be there with you. We're going to walk down We're going to walk down anyone you want, but I think right here we're going to walk down to the Capitol.
This, of course, was not true. He did not go with him to the Capitol. He left and went back to the White House. And while he was en route to the White House, violence really began to grow here at the Capitol. And within minutes of Donald Trump's speech ending, there were significant reports of escalating violence that began to surface. Buildings around the Capitol were starting to be evacuated. And by 1:15, an explosive device had been found at the DNC. A pipe bomb had been found at the RNC about 15 minutes earlier. The House Sergeant at Arms had called for immediate assistance. At 1:34 p.m., the mayor of Washington, D.C. called for additional National Guard troops. I won't go through all of the details of the violence that unfolded here. You just saw that. But as we walk through what our commander-in-chief did that day, I want to be very clear about exactly what was happening here at the same time. For 40 minutes, while buildings were being cleared, pipe bombs were being found, his supporters were literally breaching the perimeter of the Capitol and overwhelming law enforcement, and you saw the violence that was occurring. We heard nothing from the President of the United States. We didn't hear anything from Donald Trump until 1:49 p.m., when while all of this is unfolding, President Trump sent out a tweet. This was the first thing he did when he learned the United States Capitol, with all the members of Congress, his own vice president, was under violent attack. And what was that tweet? Nearly an hour after the rioters breached the Capitol perimeter at 1:49, Donald Trump released a propaganda reel of his Save America speech that he'd given an hour before. I want to be clear. The events I just described, the rioters are breaching the Capitol, attacking law enforcement. The violence is being broadcast all over the television for the whole world to see, including the President of the United States. And I want to show you, this is what is happening right before Donald Trump sends that video out again. And as he does it.
Our country has had enough. We will not take it anymore. And that's what this is all about. And to use a favorite term that all of you people really came up with, we will stop the steal. Because you'll never take back our country with weakness. You have to show strength and you have to be strong.
Even if President Trump claims he didn't know the extent of the violence that would follow his speech, it was now happening in plain view, broadcast on television. His supporters were attacking law enforcement. The mayor and the police chief were calling for help. Members of Congress and the vice president were inside, scared for their lives. And he doesn't send help. Doesn't try to stop it, doesn't even acknowledge the attack. Instead, our commander-in-chief tweeted the video of the speech that he'd given before that included language like, our country has had enough, we will not take it anymore, and that's what this is all about, you have to be strong. Those around Donald Trump, as was later reported, were disgusted. His close aides, his advisors, those working for him, former officials, even his family were begging him to do something. Kellyanne Conway, the president's close advisor, called to, quote, add her name to the chorus of aides urging Donald Trump to take action. Ivanka Trump, the president's own daughter, went to the Oval Office as soon as the rioting escalated. And was, as confirmed by Senator Graham, quote, trying to get Trump to speak out, to tell everyone to leave, end quote. Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy called Jared Kushner, pleading with him to persuade Trump to issue a statement or to do something. And Kushner, too, went down to the White House after that call. And it wasn't just the people at the White House. Members of Congress from both parties who were trapped here were calling the White House to ask for help. Some members even appealed directly to Donald Trump. These members who had, quote, been loyal Trump supporters and were even willing to vote against the Electoral College results were now scared for their lives. Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy repeatedly even got into a screaming match as the attack was underway, demanding that Trump do something, issue a statement denouncing the mob. I imagine many of you sitting here today picked up your phone and tried to reach somebody at the White House to ask for help. This wasn't partisan politics. These were Americans from all sides trying to force our commander-in-chief to protect and defend our country. He was required to do that. Now, the extent of how many people tried to reach the president to get him to act is not known. But what is clear, what we know without any doubt, is that from the very beginning, the people around Donald Trump lobbied him to take command. What's also clear is what Donald Trump, our commander-in-chief, did in those initial hours to protect us. Nothing. Not a thing. He knew it was happening. The attack was on TV. We all know that President Trump had the power to stop these attacks. He was our commander-in-chief. He had the power to assess the security situation, send backup, send help. He also had incited this violent attack. They were listening to him. He could have commanded them to leave. But he didn't. The first critical hour and a half of this bloody attack, Donald Trump tweeted his rally speech and did nothing else. And we know why. We know his state of mind that prompted his utter, complete refusal to defend us. It was reported by those around him. The president, as reported by sources at the time, was delighted. As he watched the violence unfold on television, President Trump was reportedly, and I quote, borderline enthusiastic because it meant the certification was being derailed, end quote. Senator Ben Sasse related a conversation with senior White House officials that President Trump was, quote, walking around the White House, confused about why other people on his team weren't as excited as he was, end quote. Trump's reaction to this attack reportedly genuinely freaked people out. I understand why. We just suffered a very serious attack, on our country. And we saw it, and the people around him knew it. But when Donald Trump saw it, he was delighted. Now, what President Trump did next confirms why he was so delighted, why he wanted this. Because it shows that his singular focus that day, the day we were attacked, was not protecting us, was not protecting you, was not protecting the Capitol. It was stopping the certification of the election results. The evidence is clear. Shortly after 2 p.m., as the siege was fully underway, then President Trump made a call. This is the first call that we are aware he made to anyone inside the Capitol during the attack. Didn't call the vice president to ask how he could help defend the Capitol. Didn't call the next two in line to the succession of the presidency to check on their safety or well-being. Instead, he attempted to call Senator Tuberville. He dialed Senator Lee by accident. Senator Lee describes it. He had just ended a prayer with his colleagues here in the Senate chamber. And the phone rang. It was Donald Trump. And how Senator Lee explains it is that, that the phone call goes something like this. Hey, Tommy, Trump asks. And Senator Lee says, this isn't Tommy. And he hands the phone to Senator Tuberville. Senator Lee then confirmed that he stood by as Senator Tuberville and President Trump spoke on the phone. And on that call, Donald Trump reportedly asked Senator Tuberville to make additional objections to the certification process. That's why he called. Now let's be clear, at roughly 2 p.m., when Donald Trump was walking around the White House, watching the TV delighted, and spent 5 to 10 minutes talking to Senator Tuberville, urging him to delay the election results, this is what was happening in the Capitol.
We'll pause.
Protesters are in the building.
Thank you.
You saw Senator Lankford stop speaking and leave the floor quickly in that clip because the insurgents had broken through the barricades and had entered the building. And as these armed insurrectionists banged on the doors, members of Congress were told to put on their gas masks, to put bags over their heads for safety and prepare to evacuate. And Donald Trump was calling to ask a senator to delay the certification process. Let that sink in. Donald Trump didn't get to finish that call. Was cut off because the senators had to move to another location for your security. And thank God they did, because as the call was occurring, the rioters got closer to the Senate chambers. And as we all know now, but for the heroism of Capitol Police Officer Eugene Goodman and other law enforcement officers who took them in a different direction to the police line, they very likely would have gotten here. Think about that. Armed insurrectionists, guns, weapons, zip ties, brass knuckles, they were coming for us. They were inside the United States Capitol, trying to stop the certification process. The police were outnumbered, and but for the grace of God, they would have gotten us, all of us. And our commander-in-chief makes a call about an hour after the siege began, not to preserve, protect, and defend you and our country and the Capitol, but to join forces with the mob and pressure a senator to stop certification. We just can't get numb to this kind of behavior. There can be no doubt as to the purpose of Donald Trump's call, that he was not calling to assess the security threats or to check on the well-being of you or anyone else. Indeed, later on that evening, while all of the destruction and damage still continued, dozens of officers were being treated for serious injuries, deaths were confirmed. About 7 p.m., the president's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, made a call. And just in case you don't think there was some coordination, he also called Senator Lee's phone, trying to reach Senator Tuberville. We don't have to guess as to what Rudy Giuliani said in that voicemail because we have it recorded. So let's listen to what the president's personal lawyer said on the night of this attack.
Senator Tuberville, or I should say Coach Tuberville, this is Rudy Giuliani, president's lawyer. I'm calling you because I want to discuss with you how they're trying to rush this hearing and how we need you, our Republican friends, to try to just slow it down.
This was the singular focus of Donald Trump during this bloody, violent attack on the Capitol, stopping the certification. Look, as I mentioned, I was a trial lawyer for 16 years. Sometimes you have to ask a jury to use reasonable inferences to piece together a defendant's state of mind. We don't have to do this here. While our country was violently attacked by an armed mob, President Trump not only refused to stop the attack or even address the attack at all, he made clear his focus was the same goal of the attackers he had incited, to stop the certification process and prevent the peaceful transition of power. The only action we know that he took an hour into this attack was to call Senator Tuberville to ask him to delay the certification. This is as clear evidence as I have ever seen of what Donald Trump really cared about that day. Now look, the certification process, as we all know, includes debate and objections. Some of us disagreed, but we came here on January 6th to formally administer the certification process pursuant to our constitutional duties. And at the end of it, Congress certified the results to ensure that we continue to be a country with leaders who are elected by the people for the people. Donald Trump's objection to the certification are not on trial. But what is on trial is while we were under armed attack and being evacuated, while our law enforcement officers were fighting for their lives, our commander-in-chief was calling not to determine how to best secure the building and the people in it, but to continue to pressure senators to stop the certification process and the peaceful transfer of power. Just as he incited the mob to do earlier in the day. This was a breathtaking dereliction of his duty and of his violation of his oath as our commander-in-chief. Senators, before I hand this over to Manager Castro to walk through the rest of the day, please let me make one final point. These attackers stood right where you are. They went on that rostrum. They rifled through your desks and they desecrated this place. And literally, the president sat delighted, doing nothing to help us, calling one of you to pressure you to stop the certification. It can't be that the commander-in-chief can incite a lawless, bloody insurrection and then utterly fail in his duty as commander-in-chief to defend us from the attack, to defend our law enforcement officers from that attack, and just get away with it. Donald Trump abdicated his duty to us all. We have to make this right. And you can make it right.